So section 9, the first question we have here is number 3, why did Japan expand into Vietnam? How did the U.S. react? Why did this lead to war? Well, Japan needed oil to continue its war in China. And it needed other resources to continue its war in China, so it decided it was going to expand into Vietnam because from Vietnam it could threaten Malaysia and Indonesia, where it could get oil and rubber and other things. The United States realized this Japanese need for oil, and so in order to kind of punish Japan and to tell Japan to back off, it will ban all exports of oil to Japan. While this is going on, Konoe is replaced as prime minister by Hideki Tojo, a military man. And Japan basically is hoping to develop this strategy where it's going to go out and attack the Southeast Asia, and those would be British and Indian, Dutch holdings in Indonesia and Malaysia. Take those British and Dutch holdings in Indonesia and Malaysia. Take the Philippines, take a bunch of other territories so they can get those resources that they want. And what kind of triggers this is the U.S. demand that Japan withdraw from China, right? So this puts Japan in kind of a difficult position. They need resources to continue the war with China, to win that, to get the resources they thought they needed in order to defeat the Soviet Union and to defend their empire. If they do withdraw from China, as the U.S. is demanding, that's a problem because they won't get those resources. But at the same time, they need resources from the United States. They need oil if they want to continue going. So they basically decide, initially they try and negotiate the United States. When it's clear they're not getting anywhere with negotiations, they just try to attack after stalling. And basically what's happened here is this is just like the Russo-Japanese War. Japan has been backed into a corner. It doesn't see, if it just lets things go on as they do, there's going to be a problem. If they withdraw, they're not going to get the resources they need if they withdraw from China. So their hope is to attack the United States, to grab as many of the resources as they can so that they're able to keep their empire, and then fight the United States until we enter into a negotiated peace. What were the characteristics of the Japanese declaration of war against the United States? What I want to emphasize here was that Japan still, despite waging an aggressive war, sees itself as on the defensive, right? Fundamentally, to the Japanese understanding of the war, they are on the defense. Question 12 was, how were Korean people mobilized? So Koreans were mobilized to be labor, often involuntarily. They were also mobilized as soldiers, and a significant number of Koreans, certainly not the majority, but a significant number, did volunteer as soldiers. There were Korean kamikazes. But one thing also, and this happened to other women, Western Chinese and Filipino, a lot of Korean women were forced to sexually service military men. They were put near the front lines and forced to have sex with soldiers. And this is a major cause of problems between Japan and China, Korea, and the Philippines today. So we had this question number 16, what were the characteristics of the Japan's home front? And, you know, if you look at the American home front, we have, you know, this kind of image of Rosie the Riveter and, these kind of strong women, or the bombshells, right? You know, you're either strong or you're sexy. In Japan, if you look through these slides, you see women are much more domestic. They're not presented necessarily in that kind of strong fashion. You'll notice that there are pictures of Japanese women working in a factory, but they're young women. Mothers were discouraged from working in factories. It was thought that they should be at home with their children. The most militaristic image of women, the one where they present as strongest, is this one where they're practicing kendo, but they're still definitely feminine in that image. And I think it's interesting, if you look at this picture of this young lady in this white dress holding the Japanese flag with a Navy and Air Force behind her, this is part of the... she's a housewife, and she's part of the Great Japan Housewives Association, meant to kind of encourage these things. So this is meant, she's not a young girl in a sense, she is a full-grown woman who's a housewife. So there's this kind of there's this emphasis on women's femininity. While women can work in the factories, it's young women, it's not married women, they should be at home with their kids. Another example of the home front, this toothbrush advertisement is promising children they use this brand of toothpaste, they will have the brightest smiles in the greater East Asian Cove prosperity sphere. The next image I think is very important is of a clearly Western woman. There you can see the word deluxe And this shows that even during this time period, even during war, there was this admiration for Western standards of beauty. You can see that in the next picture where there's a woman like combing her hair. And that's clearly another Western woman. And it says, if you want, if your hair is clean, then your heart will also be clean. And I think that's a kind of interesting way of mobilizing this. And one thing I think is fascinating, too, in this other image, this photo, you can see a Navy man berating a Japanese woman because she has a perm. Perms were considered corrupt, evil hairstyles of the West and should be avoided. But the Japanese women continued to have perms despite being told that.